Interested in building a new PC? Howdy howdy guys, Ponchato here, and welcome to the third episode of my monthly build series. In these videos, I'll show you the parts I would use for building gaming PCs at $500, $750, and $1,000 budgets. To keep up with changing component prices, new products, and product updates, I put up a new video every month, so be sure to subscribe to stay up to date. The big updates this month are that RAM is way more expensive, and I've taken a bit of a different angle on the $1,000 build. Without further ado, let's get started with the November 2017 edition of monthly builds. First up, we'll look at the $500 build. I recommend $500 as the starting point because below this budget, you'll be cutting some serious performance corners, though I do have a lower budget planned for the not too distant future. Anyway, for the CPU, I picked Intel's G4560 for around $85. Despite being on the LGA 1151 Gen 1 socket, going with a G4560 does allow you to upgrade in the future. You can go as high as an i7-7700K with 4 cores and 8 threads without needing a new motherboard. Speaking of motherboards, for the $500 build, I went with the Gigabyte GA-B250M DS3H Micro ATX board for around $65. Because the G4560 is a locked processor, there's really no need to spend more on an overclock-ready motherboard when we can apply that money elsewhere. If you do choose a different motherboard, be sure to get one with a 200 series chipset, that is B250, H270, or Z270, because the 100 series motherboards won't be compatible without a BIOS update. For the graphics card, I went with EVGA's GTX 1050 Ti SE Gaming for about $160. Yes, the GTX 1050 is a better value than the 1050 Ti, but with these builds, I'm aiming for maximum performance at a given budget. The money saved by getting a 1050 can't really be applied to anything else to make up for the performance loss. If you want to see my full comparison between the 1050 and 1050 Ti, that video is linked below. For the memory, I went with a single stick of Corsair Value Select 8GB DDR4 running at 2133MHz for about $90. Yeah, $90 for 8GB. Ouch. For storage, the tried and true WD Blue 1TB hard drive for about $50. It's not an SSD, but at this budget, SSDs are a bit over our price point anyway. As for the power supply, I went with the EVGA 500W1 for about $40. It comes with a 3-year warranty, and EVGA has a good reputation for their power supplies, plus 500 watts will easily cover an upgrade to, for example, a GTX 1060 in the future. The case I picked for the $500 build is once again Rosewool's SRM01 Micro ATX Tower for about $30. At this low of a budget, there are quite a few plastic junk boxes to pick from, but Rosewool rises above with slightly less plastic. In all seriousness, the components you'll be using at this budget won't need a crazy amount of case cooling, and money spent on a nicer case is better spent elsewhere to get the best gaming performance possible. All told, the $500 build ran a little over budget at $517 US, but it will give you a great start in PC gaming and a good foundation for future upgrades. If you want to pick up parts for the $500 build, links are in the description below. Next, the $750 build. Again, this seems to be the sweet spot in price to performance for a new PC, and if your budget allows for it, I'd recommend bumping up from the $500 build to this one, as it should last you quite a bit longer. For the CPU, I went with a Ryzen 3 1200 from AMD for about $110. I've covered the R3 1200 quite a bit in previous videos, and it's demonstrated pretty amazing price to performance and exceptional overclocking capability, even on stock cooling. Paired to that is the NVIDIA GTX 1060 3GB Mini ITX model from Gigabyte. At around $200, this is just about the cheapest 1060 available and will easily have you covered in any game available today. On top of that, its compact footprint will make it easy to fit into just about any case with no gigantic, awkward coolers to try and route cables around. Both of those will be plugged into the Prime B350 Plus motherboard from ASUS for around $100. It's a full ATX board with 4 DIMM slots for memory and an M.2 slot for a PCIe or SATA SSD. The best thing about it is since it's a B350 chipset, it allows you to overclock the unlocked Ryzen 3 to get even more performance. Memory is stupid expensive at the moment, but the Ballistic Sport LT 4GB isn't completely outrageous. About $56 per stick, so to get a full 8GB, the cost comes to around $100. They're rated for DDR4 2666MHz, which will also help the Ryzen 3 since Ryzen chips are so dependent on memory speed. For the SSD, I went with an ADATA SU800 128GB M.2 drive for around $55. That's enough to fit a Windows 10 install on and have a bit of room left over for smaller games like CSGO and Overwatch. For bulk storage, the WD Blue 1TB comes back at right around $50. All of that will be powered by an EVGA 600BQ semi-modular power supply for around $60. 600 watts should be more than enough for most future upgrades, and the semi-modular cables will make cable management much easier than a non-modular power supply. Plus, it comes with a 3-year warranty. Finally, for the case, I picked the NZXT S340 for about $70. It's a mid-tower case that comes with a side window and power supply shroud, and since it comes in quite a few color combinations, you have plenty of options to pick from. Altogether, these parts come in at just under $750 at $745. If there's a sweet spot for budgets between $500 and $1,000, this is it. If you want to pick up any or all of these parts, links are in the description. Finally, we'll look at the $1,000 build. Based on your feedback in the comments, I've changed this up quite a bit from my previous recommendations. The first change is the processor. This time I'm recommending a Ryzen 3 1200 for around $110. As explained before, it's a great overclocker out of the box, and since it's a true quad-core, it should have a very long useful life. The reason I went with the inexpensive 1200 is because of this. For the graphics card, I'm going with the EVGA GTX 1070 SC Gaming for about $430. It's a big increase in price from the 1060, but also a big increase in performance, somewhere north of 30%. It'll pretty much max out any game at 1080p, and you'll be well taken care of at 1440p and even into 4K gaming. For the motherboard, I picked the ROG Strix B350F from ASUS for around $120. It comes with 4 DIMM slots for memory, an M.2 slot for an SSD, and 2 USB 3.1 ports on the I/O panel. In addition to that, it has sweet RGB LEDs built into the ROG heatsink, and 2 additional RGB headers for customizable lighting. For the memory, I went with Ballistics again, this time their Elite 8GB DDR4 2666 single DIMM for around $104. This will give you the best upgrade path in the future. To get 16GB, you only need one more stick, and you'll still have 2 free slots after that in case you need even more memory later on. The SSD I picked for the boot drive is the ADATA SU800 128GB for around $55, and bulk storage will come from Western Digital with their 1TB Blue for about $50. All of this will be powered by the Seasonic Focus Plus Gold 750W for about $90. I reviewed the 850W model in a previous video and it's become one of my favorites. 80 plus gold rating, fully modular, and a fanless mode which I love. Oh yeah, and a 10-year warranty. That's a very long time. All of these parts will go into a Fantex Eclipse P400 case for about $75. With a tempered glass side panel, you can show off your components, and the case itself is quite attractive and comes in different colors to suit your fancy. All told, these parts come to $1,028, a tiny bit over budget, but you won't be left wanting for more performance, at least until the next series of graphics cards come out. Links to pick up the components for the $1,000 build are in the description below. If you want to get notified of new videos as soon as they're up, hit subscribe and click the bell icon to enable notifications. So that's it for the third episode of Monthly Builds. If you're thinking about building a gaming PC for the first time, welcome to the community, and be sure to check out my build videos to see how it's done. If you're a veteran and you just needed to catch up, I hope these recommendations helped you. So guys, if you liked this video, hit the like button. If you want to see more, hit subscribe, and if you have any questions about these builds or the components I picked, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for watching, I hope I helped, and I'll see you in the next video.